Hey everyone, this is Wartime Workshop, and this is a photo taken on May 8th, 1945, depicting U.S. troops on Okinawa listening to news of the Germans' surrender. My focus today is on the machine delivering the message, the receiver module of a Crosley BC-654 radio set. This video is part two of a series documenting the restoration of the BC-654, so if you haven't seen part one, be sure to check it out. In that video, I shared some of the history of this radio, and a tour of my personal BC-654. Today, my goal is to restore the receiver section of this historic device to operating condition. The primary challenge to booting up the BC-654's receiver comes in finding a suitable power supply. The transistor wasn't developed until after the war, so wartime receivers used vacuum tubes to perform fundamental signal processing tasks, such as amplification and rectification. Tube radio sets tend to require a complement of different voltages due to the manner in which vacuum tubes operate. In the case of the Crosley receiver, I needed to provide three supplies: 1.5 volts for the tube filaments, 90 volts for the plates, and minus 45 volts for the grid bias. The BC-654 gets its receiver voltages from a power supply mounted in the upper right corner of the device. As I covered in my last video, one could choose to install either a battery pack or an electromechanical switching mode supply. Today, I want to make a working replica of the original battery, model BA43. This model of battery pack appears to have been produced specifically for this radio, and it's become exceedingly rare. Thanks to a very generous collector, I have these reference photos of an original, on which I modeled my reproduction. To challenge myself, I decided to make my reproduction completely rechargeable, using modern cell chemistries. With dimensions from the original reference piece, I started by making the outer shell of the reproduction. I cut the blank from 14-ply chipboard, which just about matches the measured material thickness from the original. My pattern is a rough approximation, but I tried to get the order of the folds correct wherever I could. For the edges, I used a bone folder to score the material without breaking through. I connected the permanently bonded tabs with contact cement. While the original case seems to have a sort of colored facing paper, I didn't have a good way to reproduce this, so I decided I'd just paint the enclosure. Painting over the assembled box wasn't a perfect fix, because it caused the edges of the chipboard to be colored, but I was concerned the paint would crack if I applied it before cutting and folding. For coating, I'm using generic paraffin wax. I think the original battery was dipped, but I don't have a big heated vat I can use. To simulate this look, I poured an excess of wax over the box and spread it out into a thick layer. I then reflowed this treatment with a heat gun, letting the wax waterfall into a thin, uniform coating. I spent extra time with the heat gun on the hinged edges that I wanted to remain flexible for opening and closing the box. Excess wax would stiffen these hinges, causing them to fatigue. To make this reproduction convincing, I needed to recreate the labels on the original. Despite a lot of research, I couldn't find the original fonts in a digital form, so I had to manually recreate the markings. I pulled the reference images into Inkscape, scaled them, and traced them as vector graphics. I'm no typographer, but I tried to pay attention to the individual typographic features that impart a distinct look to a given font. This process can be time-consuming, but I think it adds a feeling of authenticity that would be absent if I had used substitute fonts. To avoid an overly digital look, I artificially rounded the outside corners of the symbols, using the softness and wear visible in the reference photos as a guide. To apply the image to the box, I decided to try toner transfer paper, which is normally used to prototype printed circuit boards. In the reference image, the markings appear to have been applied on top of the wax. I don't have any inks that stick to wax, but I had a hunch that I could get toner to bond to the surface. The transfer paper is basically just a glorified sticker backing sheet, and it has almost zero adhesion to wax. To prevent it from slipping around, I didn't attach it as a solid sheet. Instead, I cut the transfer into fingers branching off a continuous binding strip. This keeps the relative positions of the features the same, but allows me to transfer each line individually. I burnished the transfers into the wax using a bone folder, continuously peeling and checking as I went so I wouldn't over-burnish and distort the image. If I made any mistakes, I just scratched off the decals, reflowed the wax with a heat gun, and started over. This was a slow process, but it gave me full control over the final product. With the decals sitting on top of the wax, I lightly heated the surface, causing the toner to bond to the top layer. Now the image was as durable as the wax, and I could polish the surface without smearing. On the front of the reference battery is a cotton web strap. This strap is used to pull the battery out of its compartment in the radio. For my strap, I used post-war military surplus webbing. I masked the ends and waxed the middle section, then bonded it to the chipboard using standard white glue, which soaks nicely into cotton webbing. Finally, I had to find a way to cover up the lower pin markings that I know are missing from the reference photos. Since the reference battery was torn and peeling in this location, I decided to just tear mine similarly. Then I aged and weathered the case by beating on it, crushing the corners, and tossing it around for a while. To house the battery cells and my replica's internal wiring, I built a wooden box that could slip into the outer liner. A laser cutter made short work of the pattern, and I assembled it with wood glue. This may not be the strongest solution, but it should survive the minor drops and bumps that this piece will experience. I also cut some ribs from a square dowel and glued them inside the case to provide a locating feature for the battery packs I would be installing. I sanded down the sharp corners, and to keep the light-colored wood from sticking out, I chose to prime it and paint it OD green. I knew this would all be hidden inside the chipboard shell, so it didn't have to be too pretty. For the internals, I had to select the rechargeable cells that would provide power. I went with a nickel metal hydride D cell for the filament source. Its nominal voltage is 1.2, but it comes off the charger closer to 1.4, and I expect the radio to work fine even at a slightly lower voltage. To obtain 90 and minus 45 volts, I wanted a higher voltage per cell, so I went with a lithium ion pack. With a nominal cell voltage of 3.7, I needed 12 cells in series to get 45 volts, and 24 cells to get 90. Small lithium packs with that many cells aren't very common commercially, and most balancing chargers top out at 6 cells. So I settled on a custom pack design comprising 2 separately wired 6-cell batteries. These effectively give me a 45-volt battery if I wire the 2 circuits in series. To get 90 volts, I go another step and wire together 2 of those packs. So with a total of 3 packs, I can fully power the receiver. For charging, each pack connects to a dual smart charger as a pair of independent 6S batteries. I used 10440-sized cells, which are dimensionally equivalent to AAAs, because I don't need that much capacity for these packs to outlast the size D filament supply. The packs charge, discharge, and balance through a pair of standard 7-pin balance connectors. There are no separate power wires because the balance connector can more than handle the current draw I need. I'm using unprotected packs and relying on a high-quality smart charger to keep them balanced. This means I remain responsible for preventing these packs from becoming over-discharged. I chose the end-to-end pack layout to keep the packs within a certain dimensional envelope, which will allow them to fit inside a future project I'm planning. By standardizing the packs that I use across different projects, I can swap batteries out between devices. Feel free to guess in the comments if you think you know what I'm planning based on the form factor I used. Keep in mind that these are cheap, hobby-grade packs at best, and you shouldn't view my techniques as a tutorial in professional battery pack assembly. If you choose to work with unprotected lithium batteries, handle them with care, and invest in a fire-safe charging bag. The front octal connector of the original BA43 appears to be cardboard, and I found some signal core documents talking about the danger of using this weak material in a keyed connector. If you're not careful, you can push the alignment key right through the cardboard and potentially connect the filaments to one of the high-voltage sources. The Army eventually fixed this and moved to a plastic connector, but I really wanted my connector to match that of the reference piece. Not wanting to risk a tube blowout, I decided on a compromise. I machined off some of the thickness of a rigid plastic connector to make room for a faceplate. Then I wired up a harness for my PAX and installed this assembly into the box. I laser cut a chipboard faceplate matching the octal connector hole pattern, inked the faceplate to match the dark original, and glued it onto the front of the octal connector. The result is not perfect, but I think it's fairly convincing. The lithium packs are held into the box with hook and loop, and the filament battery holder is attached to the lid. The inner box slides into the back of the shell, and I shimmed it to fit tightly using additional chipboard. I debated using hidden hook and loop or magnets to hold the back closed, but I ultimately found a piece of tape to be the most secure option. I like that the tape just looks like a field repair, making it less obvious that the box is designed to be opened for recharging. As a final check, I verified the pin voltages, and everything looked great. I charged these lithium cells to 4 volts, so my battery will overvolt the plate and bias lines slightly when it is freshly charged. I don't expect this to cause any harm. Aesthetically, I think I achieved a pretty good match to the original. If I built another, I'd probably spend more time looking for a color-matched facing paper, or a more flexible paint, so I could color the sheet before cutting and retain some contrast on the edges of the chipboard. Alternatively, I could mask these edges during painting. Also, if I ever find a suitable ink, I'd like to try screen printing over waxed surfaces. I don't know what printing method was used on the originals, but screen printing seems like a potential candidate. With the battery ready, I next had to repair the receiver electronics. To be thorough, I cleaned the accessible surfaces on the top of the body, but this is just the surface level of the receiver. To get inside, I had to raise the receiver shelf, release the ground connection and the support linkage, and pop the receiver off its hinge. From there, it's 3 screws to get inside the housing. This is a good opportunity to appreciate the workmanship that went into these old radios. There's an insulator panel in here, but no circuit board. All the connections are made lead to lead, or with wire bundles. My concern in here is a particular flavor of capacitor. The Michelmold brand capacitors in these radios are notorious for degrading with time and moisture exposure. Despite the brand name Michelmold, these are paper caps. They were made this way to avoid using up the limited wartime supply of mica dielectric, and they definitely served a purpose, but they aren't built to last. The receiver section of the BC-654 contains 3 Michelmold caps. As a quick spot check, I clipped one of these and measured its capacitance. The value was way out of spec, more than 200% above the expected value. I suspect this was caused by leakage current, leading the meter to measure a longer time constant and overestimate the capacitance. I didn't go to the trouble of measuring the leakage, as this spot check is enough to tell me the cap is bad. Based on this result, I believe all the Michelmolds in the radio need replacement. I removed the offending component from the radio and cut it carefully down the middle with a fine blade. Then I opened the case and pulled out as much of the original foil pack as I could. I glued a high-quality modern capacitor into the case cavity, then sealed the case back up. After the adhesive dried, I painted the seam to cover the repair. I repeated this process for each of the Michelmolds in the receiver circuit. The designators for the caps I replaced are listed on screen, alongside the replacements I chose. Once all the caps were back in the circuit, I assembled the receiver case, restored the connections between modules, and returned the radio to its enclosure. With a working power supply and fresh capacitors in place, I was getting close to testing the receiver. There's no loudspeaker built into this radio, but I was lucky enough to find an original Crosley LS7 loudspeaker to go with it. The speaker had been repaired before, but it was broken when I received it. I just needed to reattach the cable to the tinsel wires. Unfortunately, Murphy's Law reared its omnipresent head, and I pulled one of the tinsel wires out of the cone while I was working on it, resulting in an ugly crack. I'm not really a speaker guy, but I probably should have realized how delicate this 75-year-old paper cone would be. I didn't even feel it as it crumbled away. After quickly going through the stages of grief, I glued the tear shut and applied a construction paper patch over the old tinsel wire hole. Then I installed a fine solder braid to serve as the new tinsel wire. After sealing and painting, the speaker was usable again, if a little ugly. Luckily, this component will be covered up by the metal grill in normal operation, so the fix will be invisible most of the time. Moments like these can be extremely discouraging. It's inevitable that I'll occasionally damage a historical piece, but I always beat myself up about it. In the long run, it's worth it to me to take minor risks if they allow me to better recreate the experience of operating this historic equipment. After reassembly, I installed a new PL55 connector onto the speaker cable. PL55 is just another designation for the standard 1/4-inch phono plug. Now, I finally had a way to listen to the output of the receiver, so it was time to check my work. I hooked up the loudspeaker and connected the radio to an improvised wire antenna. I installed the BA43 battery replica, which fit nicely into its cage. Now, without further ado... Noisy, crackly static. Just the sound we want to hear. The controls all seem to work, and even the tuner pilot light is still functioning. To get a clean test signal, I just transmitted some Morse code with my low-power Cricket 80 transceiver. On the receiver end, I was extremely pleased to hear this. With that, I'm done working on the receiver section of the BC-654. I hope this video was enjoyable, and maybe even helpful to somebody who wants to get their old radio working again. I've included links to the resources I used for this project in the description. I have to thank all the other radio and history enthusiasts who made the effort to build these sites documenting their knowledge. Projects like this wouldn't be possible without these fantastic resources. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing. And if you have any questions or ideas for future projects, please leave them in the comments. The plans for the custom hardware I made in this video are linked in the description. I hope to talk to you again in part 3. And, of course, thanks for watching.